falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. In his arms I feel protected. In his arms never disconnected. In his arms I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. In his arms, never disconnected. In his arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be.
Heavenly Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus, thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your faithfulness. We pray, God, Jesus, today. Today, Lord, as we look to you, as we serve you, as we magnify you, we ask that you would just keep your hand upon us, Lord. We pray that you would lead us and guide us as we navigate life, Lord Jesus. Help us, Lord Jesus, to be the men and women that you called us to be. Help us, Lord Jesus, to fulfill your will in our lives. Whatever that may be, Lord, I pray that today you would direct our steps, you would guide us into all truth, you would use your word today, Lord, to minister to us through the power of your Holy Spirit, that each one of us, where we are in our lives, we may glorify you, Christ. For we know you said in your word, if you be lifted up, it's then you will draw all men and women unto you. So we lift up you, Christ, today, and we pray that you just help us to draw men and women to you, to your wonderful, glorious gospel, which is the good news for us and for every man, every woman. Bless the reading of your word today. Bless the hearers of your word today. Bless me as I deliver your word through the power of your Spirit. Unction me, anoint me, guide me, that your people, Heavenly Father, that your people, your children, may be fed from your word. This is my prayer, Lord. And I thank you for this opportunity and this privilege to live for you, to serve you, and to be counted faithful to be a minister for you. We ask these things in your name, Christ. We say amen and amen. Praise God. Blessings this morning to each one of you who are logged on, and blessings to each one of you who will hear this later on our website, or via the YouTube channel, those who are on YouTube Live. You're always welcome, and thank you for participating. And my prayer is that your life my life, our lives collectively would be enriched by the word of the Lord. Doesn't matter where you came from. Doesn't matter how many faults, how many failures, all these things that mankind measures with mankind and compares man to man. None of those things matter with the Lord Jesus. He loves you. He loves me. He died for you. He died for me. And he's given us all the opportunity to live for him and live the best lives in him and through him here on this earth. So thank God for each one. I purpose in my heart, I purpose in my mind daily to look at men, look at myself and look at others, family members, colleagues, comrades, etc. Look at all men and women through the eyes and through the lens of Jesus, because I know I can't go wrong that way. Amen. And I challenge each one of you to look at your fellow man, your fellow woman, that fellow person through the eyes or the lens of Jesus Christ. That challenge is before each of us. And the more we look at men and women through the eyes of Jesus, the more we become like Jesus. All right. And we're able to encourage, we're able to edify, we're able to lift up those in our households, those in our extended families, cousins, aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews. People are looking for hope, brothers and sisters, in a world that's saturated with hopelessness. God has given you and I the opportunity through his word, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to present hope to those individuals whom we love, whom we are associated with hope, with hope. Hope makes a big difference, regardless of the individual's state of life, regardless of where they are, regardless of things they've done or things they haven't done, regardless of their intellect, regardless of their education, regardless of their financial status. None of those things matter in the eyes of the Lord Jesus, because he came and he gave his all so that you and I might have all. So let us look at men and women through the eyes, men, women, and children, through the eyes of Jesus. All right? That's how you avoid judging, unrighteous judgment, right? That's how we avoid unrighteous judgment, and that's how we allow the love of God to flow not only in us, but to flow through us. For the Bible says in Romans 5:5, that the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Romans 5:5. Then Jesus said in John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35, more so 35, 34, he talked about love. He said, greatest commandment, on and on. In verse 35, he said, all men, family members, your household, your neighbors, your community members, those who you associate yourself with, all men will know that you are my disciples, followers of me, because of the love you have one for another. So brothers and sisters, everything about Christianity is based on love. Love is the foundation. Love is the basis. Love is the essence of Christianity. Not that none of us are perfect, but brothers and sisters, give God a chance in your heart, as I give God a chance in my heart, to perfect his divine love in our lives. Hence, when we started this church, that was the essence of the name Agape, the divine love of God, agape community. So my prayer was, Lord, I want your divine love to be spread throughout, as I minister the word of God, throughout the community of family, the community that I associate myself with, the community that you allow me to come in contact with. I want that agape at the forefront, the divine love of God, not my own definition of love, but God's definition of love that's been shed abroad in my heart, that I am to walk in love, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, verse 1, verse 2, walk in love. I want that love, that agape divine love, to be shed abroad, not only in my heart, but in the hearts of others. And I want people not to see Douglas Perkins, or when they look at Douglas Perkins, I want them to see Jesus Christ, Douglas Perkins allowing Jesus Christ to be his Lord, be his guide. And that presents hope to them, right? That presents hope to that individual who's viewing my life. They view my mistakes. They view my failures. They view my mishaps. And they see that in the midst of all those things, I'm still allowing Jesus to help me navigate life. So that's the challenge. And we can do it. You know why we can do it? Know why you can do it? Because the Bible says you can. I can, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things. You can do all things through Christ. He'll give you the strength. All right. Praise God. Let's move forward here. So we have Bible study Wednesday. We've been talking about the preacher's perspective on life, and that preacher being Solomon, King Solomon, as he returned to God. That's been the emphasis, and we're teaching the book of Ecclesiastes. You can go back, you can go on the website, Agape Community Christian Church, and or DBA Doing Business as Agape Influential Ministry. You can go to that website. Or if you have a YouTube channel, you can search, or you can go to the links that I sent out, and you can review those Bible studies and various things. And I pray it's a blessing to you, not only to you. Share the word, share the love, spread the word, spread the love. So a Bible study, Ecclesiastes, and we'll be in, as the Lord leads us, we talked about chapter 1, 2, 3, and chapter 4, and I'm just kind of skimming the top, but giving you an overview. So chapter 4, Ecclesiastes chapter 4, and we'll be talking about definitely oppression. It deals with that in Ecclesiastes chapter 4. And as we move down, we'll see how far we get. But also talking about unity, and it's better to be unified than to be on your own. All right. So that's Bible study this Wednesday, 7 p.m., same station. So we love for you to participate, all right? And you have questions in your participation. I love questions. I mean, I prefer a Bible study where people just ask a question or two, and we build the Bible study off that question, because the Bible doesn't change, right? We can incorporate Ecclesiastes chapter 4 in the question you ask. So I challenge you, I encourage you to ask questions, questions that may be related to Ecclesiastes, may not be, questions that you've had concerning church, concerning what someone said concerning God. We're here to try to answer those questions as God enlightens us to the question you have with the answer. So today we want to talk about the church, the ecclesia, right? The church, the ecclesia in the Greek, which is the called out one. So that's the only announcement I have. I do have a prayer announcement. Pray for those family members who are in bereavement. I was at a funeral this past Tuesday. Continue to pray for, and I'll just say the names, the Promise family, as they lost a family member, a loved one, mother, and grandmother. Pray for them. Also pray for the Haygood family. Pastor Haygood passed away. My mother's pastor, who's in LA. I've known him for close to 30 years. Pray for them. He passed away. He was a minister in LA for well over 30 years, probably 40 years, 50 years, probably, well known in the community of LA. So as his funeral is coming up this coming week, I believe it's Friday, if my recollection serves me correctly. Also, my niece, Perkins family, my niece's family, Erica, her grandmother also passed away. And so that would be for the Williams and Fitzpatrick family. So it's my niece, Erica. So we want to make sure we pray for them, all right? And all those others that I didn't mention, but you're aware of, be sure to pray for them. And just pray for yourself, pray for others who are dealing with health issues, mental health issues, spiritual health issues. Pray for those who have been called and who are ministering for the Lord, because there are many challenges on this side of the pew, this side of the pulpit, daily challenges in the ministry. So we want to pray for those who have been called and accepted the call and who are actively laboring in the call which God has called them for, called them to do his will. So pray one for another. First Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. Thanks and intercessions be made for all men, right? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 2. All right, praise God. Let's get into the word of God here. I'll be reading from Matthew today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, bless your word as it goes forth. Bless the hearers of your word, Lord. I pray that you would draw every man, every woman under the sound of my voice closer to you, Jesus. For those who know you, draw us closer to you through hearing your word, for we know faith cometh by hearing and hearing by your word. And for those who do not know you but will hear today, Lord, I pray that through the pulling power of the Holy Spirit, you draw them to you through the hearing of your word, that they may also believe, that they may also trust, that they may also have confidence in you, Jesus, to never leave them nor forsake them. Bless your word as it go forth. In your name, Christ, we ask these things and we say amen and amen. And as the psalmist said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you're my strength and you're my redeemer. That's taken from Psalm 19, verse 14. All right, let's jump into the word of God. Matthew chapter 16. I'll start in verse 13. And today I want to speak to you about the church, God's tool on earth. The church, which is God's tool here on earth. Nothing else. The church, the body of Christ, the spiritual body of Christ, in the Greek, the ecclesia, which means the called out ones, is a tool, God's tool, Elohim, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. The church, the spiritual body of Jesus, is the tool in the hands of Elohim, of the Trinity, here on earth. Let us dive into it. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. Excuse me. I'm reading from the King James Version of the Bible. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Whom do men say that I am? Or who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that you are John the Baptist. Some say Elias or Elijah. And others, Jeremias or Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." So different ones had different opinions, different views on the question that Jesus asked them. Jesus knew who he was. Jesus knew the answer to the question. I'm teasing my wife. Jesus knew the answer to the question, but Jesus still asked. Having fun. You know, you got to have fun as a Christian, right? Have fun with your spouse. Have fun with your friends. All right. Verse 15, he said unto them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. This was significant. Let me just do a little bit of expository here. This was significant because Jesus asked the question, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, or the Son of Humanity in the flesh, the Son of Humanity am? And Simon Peter responded, one of the individuals who responded, others responded, some say you're Elijah, some say you're Jeremiah, some say you're one of the other prophets. Simon Peter responded, you are the Christ. This is significant because the word Christ means the anointed one sent from God. So based on the Jewish prophets, which they were familiar with, Isaiah in particular, Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1 and 2, which says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he hath anointed me. He hath anointed me to preach the gospel. Jesus reiterated that in Luke chapter 4, verse 14, verse 15 as well. So here we have insight to Simon Peter's relationship and desire in his heart to the point where the Father in heaven, God the Father in heaven, spiritually revealed to Simon Peter in all his faults, in all his failures, in all his mishaps, the Father revealed to Simon Peter that Jesus wasn't just the Son of Man, but he was indeed the Christ, the anointed one sent from God. And then notice how Peter said this, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, not dead God. All those other individuals that other people had named, Jeremiah, Elijah, and all, they were no longer with them. But Simon said, you're the Christ, and you're the Son of a God who is alive. All right, verse 17. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, or blessed are you, Simon Barjona, the son of Jonah, Simon, the son of Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not or did not reveal this truth to you, but my Father which is in heaven. So Jesus took away all questions, all curiosity, all doubt. Jesus says it was the Father in heaven, my Father in heaven, who revealed this truth to you. Verse 18, and then Jesus goes on and Jesus says, and now I say unto you that thou art Peter. Now, there's a reason he called him by a different name. He referred to him, if you notice in verse 6, not Jesus speaking, he says Simon Peter. Simon's in front. And then Jesus responds to him in verse 17, Simon. But now in verse 18, he said, I will say unto you that you are Peter. Thou art Peter. The reason for that is from the Greek, or the Hebrew translation, the Greek translation, the name Simon refers to, I'll just kind of simplify it, a reed that's shaken in the wind. And now Jesus basically did a name change. and said, you are now Peter. You're not just a reed shaking in the wind. Every time the wind blows, you flow with it, and you flow with this, and you flow, you're going with the flow. No, Peter. No, Simon, you're now Peter. You're now Peter, and you're going to be a rock, no longer shaken and tossed to and fro by every form of doctrine that man come up with. But you're going to be solid. You're a rock, solid foundation. So hence he says, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. So 2 points here. The rock being the truth of what Peter said, that Jesus is the Christ. That's the rock. Jesus is the solid rock, right? Built on that truth that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the one sent from God, Emmanuel, the author and finisher of our faith, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last. Jesus told Peter, upon that rock, upon that truth, upon that gospel, upon that good news, I'm going to build my church. Upon the truth will I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I'm speaking to you today about the church, the ecclesia, God's tool on earth. Let me read another scripture to you guys. The Bible tells us, so when we talk about the church, many come to a consensus in the religious world, religious community, come to a consensus that the church is, well, people have different, I shouldn't say many come to a consensus. Many people that I know come to a consensus that the church is the spiritual body of Jesus Christ. The church consists of not a structural building, but that the church is made up of men and women who are born again, believers, followers of Jesus Christ. And we have scriptures to prove that to be factual. And I'll get to them as the Lord leads. So the church is the spiritual body of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'll read it. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12, it reads, for as the body is one and have many members, one body with many different members, and all the members of that one body being many, they're still one body. So also is Christ. So Paul is giving us some insight and enlightening the reader to what the church is and who is the church. So he says, so I'm giving you a parallel or analogy of the human body. The human body has many members, fingers, eyes, ears, nose, legs, many internal organs, but it is all a part of one unit. Hence, it's one body. So is the church or the spiritual, this is a key word, the spiritual body of Jesus Christ. So he goes on in verse 13, he says, for by one spirit are we all baptized, by one spirit are we all baptized into one body. What spirit is that? It's the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 8, the Holy Spirit, one of his names is the Spirit of adoption. We weren't physically born into the family of God, but through the adoption process, spiritual adoption into the body of Christ, as a result of the Holy Spirit baptizing us or submerging us or placing us, taking us out of this family, or we were not born into this family, but he took us and placed us through baptism, spiritual submersion, into the body of Christ. And we all are unique, because just like our human bodies, we have unique members, many unique members, so does the body of Christ. But we're all a part of the same unit, which is the spiritual body of Christ, right? Even though we're different members. And it's the Holy Spirit who, according to Romans chapter 8, I believe verse 11 through 16, that he is the spirit of adoption. And it's because he has adopted us and placed us and submerged us into the body of Christ. Hence, we cry, Abba, Father, my dear Father, right? Because we're part of the body of Christ, the family of God. So now, brothers and sisters, you can say, my Father in heaven, because of spiritual adoption that has taken place as a result of our Romans chapter 10, verse 9. We confessed with our mouth and we believed in our heart that God the Father raised God the Son, Jesus, from the dead, and hence we are saved, saved from the power of sin. And I'll get to a scripture in just a moment. So hence fulfilling what Jesus said to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, starting in verse 5. Right, so use this as a teaching moment. It's not always preaching fast, but it's teaching moment, reminding us, especially when we're talking about the church. Okay? So for by one Spirit, we are all baptized, submerged, placed, adopted into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free. We have all been made to drink into one Spirit. So regardless of your background, regardless of where you were raised, regardless of all these prerequisites and measurements that man places on man, God says, I don't care about any of that. Everyone has the opportunity, regardless of their ethnicity, regardless of their race, regardless of their educational background, regardless of their environment, the opportunity for everyone and anyone is available to be part of the family of God, to be adopted into the body of Christ. All right, verse 14. For the body is not one member, but many. So he just reiterated what he said in verse 12. So now we go to Colossians. If there's any questions, Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. It's talking about Jesus here. And I'm just going to start in verse 18 and just read part of it. But you can go back and read Colossians chapter 1. And I'm reading part of verse 18, but read the whole chapter. It talks about Jesus. So verse 18 of Colossians chapter 1 says this, and he, referring to Jesus, is the head of the body that Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Jesus is the head of that body. Same writer. Paul was writing to Colossians. He was also writing to the church in Corinth. Jesus is the head of the body, and it tells us the church. It tells us that the body of Christ is the church, and Jesus is the head. Now, there's many members in that body. Jesus is the head, the command center, the control center. He's the brain of the body. The brain does what? Our brains does what? Our brain has our central nervous system, and it sends out these impulses to our hands, tells our hands what to touch, tells our feet where to walk, tells our eyes what to look at, what to focus on, tell our mouth, our nose, what that smell is, or our mouth, what that taste is, our palate, on and on and on. The brain is the central command center of the body. So the body, the members of the body, are tools that the brain uses to fulfill its will. Jesus being the brain, the central command center, the members are extensions of the brain, all connected to the body, and they are tools to fulfill the desire and the will of the brain. So as a result, the members, hands, feet, eyes, nose, ears, etc., receive commands from the brain and then execute those commands for the brain. That's how our body works. That's how the church works. That's why Jesus is the head of the body and the body is the church. What am I talking about here? I'm talking about the tool, God's tool on earth is the church. God's tool on earth is the church. As we think about the word tool, what comes to your mind? What comes to my mind when I think about tool, or someone mentions a tool, I think about an instrument or instruments that's used to build, an instrument or instruments that's used to construct, to fix, to resolve an issue. I go to my toolbox. Or we teach in the business world, we're going to provide you a toolbox, right, of information so that you can build a strategic plan. You can build a teaching lesson. You can build, you can construct, and or I'm going to provide you the tools so that you can accomplish what you want to do or what your goal, what your aim is. We need tools in our lives, be it education, whatever the tools may look like, whatever they may be. We need an assortment of tools to accomplish what we desire in life. Well, God needs a tool here on earth for his will to be accomplished here on earth. In the model prayer, what did Jesus say to us? He said, when you pray, pray, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. How's his will going to be done on earth as it is in heaven? He's going to need a tool, and that tool is the church. That instrument is the church, and the church is the body of believers who have been adopted and placed in this body, baptized in this body by the Holy Spirit. So we have the Trinity always working together, and we're always referencing the Trinity because they are working together so that their will, Elohim's will, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, will be accomplished here on earth using the tool that they have in place on earth, which is the church. You and I, brothers and sisters, you and I. It's not the building. The building, a structure, doesn't do anything for God. And God established that in the Old Testament. He said he doesn't reside in temples made by hands, by man's hands. But he does reside in the temple that's in you and I. 1 Corinthians 6, 19-20 says, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. For we have been bought with a price. So the church is not a building or a campus that's been made by man's hands. The church is a collective, a collective body of individuals who believe, who've accepted, who've repented of their sins, who've accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, who've been adopted into the family of God by the Holy Spirit, who've experienced the new birth. Again, Nicodemus, John chapter 3, verse 5, verse 6. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Romans chapter 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, who's the head of the body. All right. So God's tool on earth, as he said in the model prayer, your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. He uses the church to do his will here on earth. No other thing. For God's will to be accomplished on earth, it comes through the church. The many members of the spiritual body of Christ, Jesus being the command center, the control center, he says, Doug Perkins, I want you to go this way. John Doe, I want you to go that way. I want you to do this. I want you to do that. As we read throughout the New Testament, as well as the Old Testament, especially in the New Testament, God's will was accomplished. The gospel, the good news of Jesus was being spread through whom? Through the disciples, through the apostles, through those who were in the church. They were, and we are an extension of God. Hence, he said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, notice this. He said, if any man be in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5, 17, if any man be in Christ, he, she, they are new creatures. Notice how I use those pronouns, how people, we're hearing pronouns. He, she, they are new creatures in Christ. Old things are passed away. Open your eyes. Remove the scales from your eyes. Allow the Holy Spirit to remove the scales from your eyes. Behold, all things have become new. Don't live in the past. Don't reflect in the past. Don't allow your yesterday to govern your today, because if you allow it to govern your today, then you don't have a future. But do as Paul said, this one thing I do, I forget those things which are behind me. I remember them, but I don't live in them. I don't let them dictate. I don't let them govern. I don't let them control my present life in Christ, because I'm striving towards perfection, and I'm perfected in the love of God. Why? Because I'm a part of the body of Christ. Because now I cry, Abba, Father. Now my desire, now my longing is to do what? Fulfill the Father's will. And I can do that. You can do that, because greater is he that is in you and me than he that is in the world. And the great one in us is Jesus, and he's going to give us the strength so we can make the profession, brothers and sisters. I can, I will, I shall do all things through Christ who strengthened me. He strengthens me because I'm a part of his body. I've been baptized into his body. I can call out to my Father. I trust in him. He is the anointed one sent from God. And I realize and I recognize, as Preacher Perkins is talking, I realize that I'm a tool in the hands of God, my Father, Jesus, my Savior, my Christ, Holy Spirit, my Comforter. I am a tool. Recognize today that you are a tool in the hands of God, so that his will in heaven will be also duplicated here on earth. He's calling you and me as being in the toolbox to fulfill his will. We are the church. How does he do this through the church? How does the church operate? How does God operate through the church on the earth to do his will? I'll say it again. How does God, Elohim, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, how does the Trinity operate through the church, the entity called the church, which is the body of Christ, spiritual body of Christ, in order to accomplish his will, duplicate his will in heaven, duplicate his will and emulate his will in heaven, that it be done here on earth? How does he do it? Through the church. How does he do it through the church? Now let's go back to 1 Corinthians 12. 1 Corinthians 12, and this is something that's talked about a lot, spiritual gifts. What's the purpose of spiritual gifts? What is the purpose of spiritual gifts? I hear a lot of conversation around the spiritual gifts, but I never really hear the purpose. God's purpose for the spiritual gifts. I hear people talking about, you have the gift of this, you have this spiritual gift, and you have that spiritual gift. What is God's purpose for the spiritual gifts? Because a person can be gifted and can be lifted up in pride through that gift. But God has a purpose. God has a reason behind the distribution of the spiritual gifts. I'll summarize it, then I'll go into it. The purpose and the reason for the spiritual gifts, as we call them, and they're not limited to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 14. They're not limited to those gifts. There's many more that's not listed. Well, I guess they are listed. You can go to the website. I taught about them under Bible studies, the trichotomy of spiritual gifts of 1 Corinthians. No, that's 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Anyway, on the website, you can go there and I have spiritual gifts and I talk about them in detail. I think you can even download, a paper I put on them. I spoke about them verbally, did a YouTube video, but then also paperwork on it, all right? God uses spiritual gifts. God uses the church and saturates the church, the body of believers, with spiritual gifts to accomplish his will here on earth. And God's will here on earth is the salvation of souls. So as we look at those spiritual gifts that God has made available to every one of us, it doesn't matter if you're a pastor or bishop or evangelist, if you're in the body of Christ, so we established that foundation, you're in the body of Christ, you're a member of the body, Jesus being the Lord of all of us, the command center of all of us, regardless of position and titles and on, the spiritual gifts are available to every member of the body, every member of the church. That's how the Bible reads that I, that's how I read the Bible and study the Bible. God uses the church in the world by inundating and blessing them with the gifts from God. Let's look at it. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8. So notice, we've already been in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, haven't we? Starting in verse 12, it's talking about the body of Christ, establishing that the body is the church. Jesus, Colossians 1:18, is the head of that body. Previously to Paul giving us an expose on the body, he told us about these gifts. And even before the gifts, starting off that chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he incorporated the Trinity, the God of operations, of administrations, and manifestation. What is that dealing with? It's the Trinity, right? It's God's will. God the Father, operations. God the Son, Jesus, administration. And then the Holy Spirit, God, he's the distributor. He executes the Trinity's will on earth. He executes the Trinity, Elohim's will on earth through the church by spiritual gifts. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is packed, right? We're introduced to the Trinity, Elohim, God the Father over operations, God the Son over administrations, and then God the Holy Spirit, the manifester. He manifests, he reveals these gifts to the members in the body because the members of the body needs these gifts in order to fulfill the will of God here on earth. It's not in our power. Notice what Zechariah said, Old Testament. He said, chapter 4, verse 6, I believe it is, or reverses 6, 4, one of the two. Zechariah said, it's not by might, not by my might, my internal power, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Jesus reiterated that. He says, don't go out in ministry, Luke chapter 24, verse 49, Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Old Testament, Joel chapter 2, verse 28. Luke 24, 49, he says, tarry in the city of Jerusalem. One of his one last commandments he gave the disciples. Tarry in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued or until ye be clothed with power from on high. Don't go out there and try to minister. Don't go out there and try to do God's will. Don't go out there and try to be a tool on the earth, in the earth, for God, without being inundated, baptized in the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is going to give you power and the Holy Spirit will enable you. He'll distribute these gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, starting in verse 8, he'll distribute these gifts that you're going to need in order to fulfill the will of God. God's tool, brothers and sisters, here on earth is the church. And the Spirit inundates us with these gifts that we call spiritual gifts. We call them spiritual gifts because they're from the Holy Spirit. And the purpose of these gifts is so that we can do God's will here on earth. And God's will here on earth, Jesus said it in John 12, 32, is to what? Lift up Jesus so that all men and women will be drawn unto him. The church is, and I don't want to go into all the details of this and make it argumentative, but the church is not here to be some social entity. It may participate in social activities. It's not here to glorify a man and put a man on a pedestal. Oh, that's Pastor so-and-so, or the evangelist so-and-so go to that church, or Pastor so-and-so pastors that church, or First Lady of this one. That's not the purpose for the church. It's been changed. It has been changed over the years. It's been, and as a result of its changing over the years, the church is viewed differently than the way God determined it to be viewed. It's viewed as a place of, hey, you go to church and you prosper financially. You go to church and you can rub shoulder with this one and rub shoulders with that one. No, those are the four walls or that campus. But the church is the body of Christ. And the true church is the tool that God uses here on earth. Let me read to you here. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, then I'll get back to the gifts. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says this. Ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That scripture makes reference to you and I, who have been called out of darkness into the marvelous light, called the body of Christ, which is the truth, right? Jesus said, I will build my church on this truth. I will build it on what? The light. Light brings about truth. Light brings about hope. Hence, that's why Jesus said in John chapter 1, I am the light of the world. I brought truth into the world, a world that's full of darkness, a world that with the darkness comes hopelessness, but light brings hope. Brothers and sisters, we are the light. The light is shining through us. Let me say it that way. The light of Jesus shines through us to bring hope to a hopeless people, hopeless nation, hopeless world, hopeless family members. We are God's tool here on earth, as the church, the body of believers, and the Holy Spirit inundates us, distributes to us, disperses to us necessary gifts for us to utilize to do what? Fulfill the will of God. Let's look at it and then we'll close. This is how God uses the church in the world. 1 Corinthians 12:8-14. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. People say, I own the gift of wisdom. No, you don't. The Holy Spirit distributes the wisdom of God. Remember in 1 Kings chapter 3, Bible study, Solomon prayed for wisdom and God said, I gave you wisdom. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, the Bible says, wisdom is made, Christ is made unto wisdom for us. We go to James, I believe, James chapter 1, he says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask God. He lets us know that God is the author of wisdom and the Holy Spirit distributes divine wisdom to the church, the body of believers, in order for us to do God's will here on earth. We are God's tool. Let's go through them a little bit more. He says, so for one is given the word of wisdom, to another one, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. So wisdom, knowledge, these are things Solomon prayed for, 1 Kings chapter 3. God is still, through the Holy Spirit, dispersing them to the church. So like Solomon in his early days in his reign, he fulfilled God's will. It's the same thing with you and I. God, through the Holy Spirit, is dispersing to us these various gifts at the particular times that we need them so that we can fulfill God's will here on earth. Then he goes on, verse 9, to another faith, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. Notice the emphasis, by the same Spirit. So faith, healing, tongues, interpretation of the tongues, all these different gifts. And there's three categories. Go to Bible study, I've already taught on it. Three categories of these gifts. But they're all dispersed and they're distributed to the members in the body, which is the church, so that we can fulfill God's will. Brothers and sisters, we are God's tool here on earth. I want you to think, as I come to a close here, I want you to really think about it and focus on it. You're God's tool. And I'm gonna just say this, you're God's tool as a member of the church, the body of believers. I want you to see yourself as God's tool to reach your family. I want you to see yourself as God's tool to reach your coworkers. I want you to see yourself as God's tool to reach your neighbors. I want you to see yourself as God's tool to reach your community. You're God's tool. And in this toolbox, we have everything we need. We have the armor of God. Put on the whole armor of God. We have prayer. We have peace. We have joy. We have everything God has provided us, everything within the toolboxes to present to the world that they're longing for, that they're desiring. The world is desiring peace. They always talk about world peace. It's through Jesus, and we have it. Joy. There's everyday joy, not just on a holiday, not just on Christmas. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Joy to the world that the Lord wants to live in you. We have joy, we have peace, we have long-suffering, we have grace, we have mercy, all in the toolbox. We have wisdom, we have knowledge, we have healing, we have faith, we have tongues, we have interpretation of tongues, all in the toolbox that God has given us. Brothers and sisters, we are the tools. We're the tools. You're the tool. Don't look at yourself and compare your present self to your past. Look at yourself today and say, I'm a tool in the hands of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Now that scripture, the scripture I can do all things through Christ. That's real. It's not just quoting it. It's not just hearing it. I know why I can say that. I know why you can say that, because I'm a part of the church. I'm a part of the body of born again believers. And God uses the church as his tool here on earth. There's nothing he can't do in me or through me to lift up Jesus, to reach my brother, reach my sister, reach my mother, reach my daughter, reach my son. God can do all things through me to lift up Christ, to make a difference in this world, to be impactful, to be influential, so that men and women, those you're associated with, to reach them for Jesus. His will, the Bible tells us in Peter, is not for any man to perish, but that all would come to the knowledge of repentance and accept Jesus. Brothers and sisters, we're the church. We're the spiritual body of Jesus Christ. We are the tool that God is using in the world for such a time as this. Don't doubt yourself. Don't limit yourself. Recognize the God that's in you. For greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. And the great God in us has us in the world to make a difference in the world. Hence, Jesus's prayer in John 17, Father, they are in the world, but they are not of the world. Keep them from the evil that's in the world, but keep them in the world to fulfill our will. Amen and amen. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we thank you for your word. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the church. I thank you for my brothers. I thank you for my sisters. I thank you for every member. Lord, we may have difference of opinions. We may have different ideas. It's because we're unique. And thank you for making each one of us unique, Lord Jesus, because it's through that uniqueness, we all bring that to the body. We're all members of the same body, and we're allowing Jesus to be the command center, the central nervous system, and we're allowing the Holy Spirit to disperse and distribute to us the gifts that we need to fulfill your will. I pray that you continue to bless my brothers, bless my sisters, bless the church as we pray for the church, Lord. We pray for men and women who are without. We pray for men and women who are within the body. We pray, Lord, as you said in your word, Romans chapter 2, that the goodness and the forbearance of the Lord leads to repentance. I pray for those who are within the body. Lord, I pray that we all learn and we execute to come, Hebrews 4:16, that we come to the throne of grace, that we may obtain a mercy and find grace to help us as we navigate this world. Help me, help my brothers, help my sisters, help those I do not know of, those who are around the world, but they're a part of the body of Christ. Help us to do thy will and to do thy will, thy way, and that men and women may come to the saving knowledge of you, Jesus. We thank you, we praise you, we glorify you, and we pray for such a time as this. For such a time as this, God, inundate us with your peace, inundate us with your joy, inundate us with your hope. Christ, you in us, that's the hope of glory. We ask these things and we believe. In your wonderful name, we say amen. And I say, God bless you to all the YouTube live folks. I say, God bless you to those who will look at this via the website, via YouTube. And I say, God bless to all of you. As I stop the recordings here, all of you are currently on. Praise God.